cell phone. You just put those on silent for us. Okay then. Morning again.
Morning.
My name is Desmond Hunt and I'll be your moderator for this lecture. Welcome to this lecture given to you by the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research Incorporated. It's a school, not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any other religious organization. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational religious, and a scientific research organization dedicated to showing you proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, his pattern and the plan operating throughout eternity till this present day. Now, this school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. We were later on incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Now, since that time, we have established grand schools throughout the United States, Canada, Africa, and several other foreign countries. Our local grand school was established in Kingston, Jamaica in the year 1988, and our Spanish Town branch was incorporated in the year 1994. Now, at this school, we teach by the true name of our Heavenly Father, the Word, our Son, and the Holy Spirit containing the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted as Lord. The true title for the Word, our Son, is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted as God. The true name and title for the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua, the Messiah. It has been erroneously substituted as Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles, not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and verse 5 that there are lords many and gods many, but we now know each lord must have a name and each god must have a name also. Now Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. Now this therefore means Elohim is a title our Creator chose for himself. Now, Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in a good dictionary or encyclopedia will show proof that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek, nor the Latin language has any characters or letters in the alphabet that would produce the sound made by this letter J, and neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after Yahshua Messiah's death. Now, therefore, such names as Jesus, Jehovah, and Jah, impossible rendering of the true original name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Now, Christ is a title just like Lord and God. All right, here is our Mosaic chart, and I would like to direct your attention. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, Yahweh is incomprehensible, inscrutable, and invisible. For Yahweh is the ultimate source, the infinite and immaculate substance. Yahweh is the limit and the bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in this pure spirit state, symbolized and discharged as a cloud. However, Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize or to depict himself, because a cloud has no particular descriptive shape or form. We have drawn this orange fiery cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you how everything on this chart abides within this cloud. Now, in like manner, does everything in the universe abide within the pure spirit state of Yahweh? Now, Yahweh, knowing man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, he took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. Now, this is the Word, our Son, a super incorporeal being, or a great heavenly anthropomorphic being that is having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form would only be seen in divine vision and understood in divine revelation. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world erroneously called Jesus Christ. Now, there is only one name given unto salvation, and we must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should ask: what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plain? A further understanding of this name and title may be asked by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. So this school teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. Now Yahweh instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. See, the pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. Now these three compartments make up this one tabernacle pattern. Now we go about in this school to show you how that everything in the universe is made and operate according to the structure and the function of this tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes this pattern. There are 10 primary constitutional objectives or aims of this institute, and they are as follows. First aim is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without the distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third aim is to investigate the unexplained spirit law or the so-called law of nature and the power latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the studies of the scripture, comparative religion, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth aim is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operations of Yahweh's eternal purpose operating throughout the dispensations and ages. Seventh aim is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth throughout the dispensations of time. Eighth aim is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man must be saved save in the name Yahshua the Messiah. Tenth aim is to earn is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan, speak the truth. Okay, for this morning lecture of the IMF, the Edmar Mile Gully Brand School, we will have prayer by Dr. Winsome Martin. Scripture lesson will be taken from Hebrew the 4th chapter, read by Dr. Cynthia Martin.
I'm reading from the Holy Name Bible, and I'm reading from Hebrews 4, chapter. Okay. Let us therefore fear, lest a promise being left us of entering unto his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. For unto us were the glad tidings preached, as well as unto them, but the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that hear it. For we which have believed do enter unto rest, as he said, as I have sworn in my wrath, if they shall enter into my rest, although the work were finished from the foundation of the world. For he speak in a certain place of the Sabbath on this wise, and Elohim did rest the seventh day from all his work. And in this place again, if they shall enter unto my rest, sin therefore it is remain, the some much enter therein, and they to who it was first preached enter not in because of unbelief. Again, he limit a certain day, saying in David, today, after so long a time, as it is said, today he will hear his voice, hearken not your heart. For if Joshua, the son of Nun, has given them rest, then would he not afterward have spoken of another day? He said, there remained, therefore, the keeping of the Sabbath to the people of Elohim. For he that is entered unto his rest, he also have ceased from his own work, as Yahweh did for him from his. He said, let us do our utmost. Therefore, to enter unto the rest, let any man fall after the same example of unbelief. For the word of Yahweh is quick and powerful and sharper than any tongue, any two-edged sword, piercing even the dividing asunder of the soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow. It is a discerner of thought and intent of the heart. He said, neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and open unto the eyes of him which we have to do. Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed unto the heaven, Yahshua the son of Yahweh, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with feeling of our infirmities. Mm-hmm. But was in all point tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in times of need.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. If y'all would speak loudly and clearly, we have people watching online that are saying they can't hear clear enough. So if you speak loudly and clearly, that's why I moved closer.
Okay, what we'll be doing this morning, we'll be having a workshop, and that workshop will be conducted by Dr. Donna Mitchell.
Yeah, it's open for a question and answer, short testimony or short principle. So who had a question?
Okay, I have one. I know that the corner or this is the Ten Commandments, it was done away with. It was the corner ordinances, it was done away because Yahshua nearly to the cross. But I was speaking to somebody and he said if you done away with that's mean if they can go and do, we can do everything that we want to do.
Dr. Frank Lewis can answer. She was thinking about the carnal ordinances.
And being done away with, and you can do anything you want.
Yeah.
Common.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Great.
So, yeah, that's definitely a big question. There's so much to answer with that, really. But we'll do it. I guess you can do it this way. Well, let's just do it this way. Read Revelation, 12th chapter. Because this kind of goes along with what Winsome had asked about earlier. How did the devil come about? Why is there good and evil? And then now you got the question about the law.
When the temple of Yahweh was opened in heaven,
Okay, that's just start at Revelation 12 and 8 yours, and 12 and 7 King James.
Mm-hmm. Oh. And there was war in heaven.
Yeah.
Michael and his angels fought against the dragon. And the dragon fought and his angels.
And see, this war in heaven is before there's a physical creation. Mm-hmm. So he says, and there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon and his angels. Read.
And prevailed not.
And prevailed not. So that means that the devil was in heaven. You understand? And his angels. This is the angelic host. Heaven is a state of spiritual existence. Okay? Not a place, but that's what we think about heaven before you come into the school. Read.
Neither was their place found anymore in heaven.
So their place was not found anymore in heaven. That means they were cast out. And really the purpose is that that left a place for the souls of men. You understand?
Mm.
See?
Mm.
And that's really what it is. Those angels were cast out, never to return. Yahweh creates a physical creation and has mankind with souls, and he's saving souls to take place of those that were cast out.
That's right.
That's the purpose. Read.
And the great dragon was cast out.
The great dragon was cast out.
That old serpent.
What old serpent? That same one that... See, that's why Adam had to transgress. You know, he was given a law. Mm-hmm. See, in Genesis... Genesis 2 and 7, he said, form man from the dust of the ground, breathe his nostrils, breath of life, he became a living soul. See, that means he's alive spiritually and psychologically. Then in Genesis 2:16, it said, Yahweh Elohim command a man, saying, of every tree of the garden you can freely eat, but a tree of the knowledge of good and evil, don't eat, for a day you do, you'll surely die. Now, why did Yahweh say, in the day that you eat, you'll surely die? He knew he was going to transgress.
Right.
Why? Because it happened in the angelic realm. Mm-hmm. See, what the angelic happened first, then the physical's a reflect of that. Mm-hmm. You understand? And Adam's in the most holy place, and there's only one direction to go. Down. You understand? See, when you're doing a pattern, if you're in the most holy place, only way you can go is down. So it's a descending plate. And really, he's representing the angels there because they didn't have no children there in the most holy place.
Mm-hmm.
You understand? He's not conscious of the physical things. He's more or less in Yahweh's rest or Sabbath. He's in the Sabbath. He don't even have to do nothing. Mm-hmm. He was supposed to trim the trees, but he's just resting, really. You understand? But in Daytrid, okay. So I know it's a long way around, but I will say this. Now, when you go to Hebrews 1 and 6, that's where you more or less read about, and it's only in the Holy Name Bible. I think it's Deuteronomy 32:43, when it will talk about, we'll just read it. I think it's 1 and 6 of Hebrews.
In the Holy
This
Name.
Was the law given to the angels. In other words, there's a law.
Right.
Before you can transgress or before you can sin, wouldn't there have to be a law that you transgressed or sin?
Yeah.
See?
If sin is transgression of the law.
Yeah, read the...
Hebrew 1 and 6?
I think so.
And again, when he bringeth the first begotten into the world,
yeah,
he said, and let all the angels of Elohim worship him.
Let all the angels worship him. Mm-hmm. You understand? You're supposed to worship the Creator. But what the devil's job is, you read, boy, there's a lot here. When you go to Ezekiel and Isaiah, we might as well get those. Because what I'm doing is tying in the satanic spirit along with the law, okay? Read Isaiah 14 and 12. Let's finish up Revelation, though. And
that old serpent.
Yeah. So what old serpent? That one back in Genesis 3. You understand? You're clear in Revelation. It talks about that dragon was cast out. That old serpent.
Called the devil.
Called the devil.
And Satan.
And Satan.
Which deceiveth the whole world.
He deceiveth the whole world.
He was cast out into the earth.
Yeah.
And his angels were cast out with him.
Yeah. His angels are cast out with him. See? And so he... So those angels were cast out in the angelic realm. And where are they? Well, angels are ministering spirits. Oh, and after they were cast out, read what happened.
And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven,
yeah,
now is come salvation.
See, when demons were cast out of heaven, or when the dragon and his angels, or Lucifer, Satan, devil, and his one-third, it said his tail drew a one-third part of the stars. Mm-hmm. That means his tail drew one-third of the angelic host. He was cast out, never to return. And see, where is he? He's down on the earth plane now. You're the man for that.
Okay. Just trying to help.
Where is he down? He's down on the earth plane, deceiving people. You understand? And angels are ministering spirits. That's why there's so many in the ministry. Mm-hmm. And there's more, as many demons you have, that's how many doctrines there are. Mm-hmm. In other words, he got all kind of teaching out here. And everybody's got an idea of what things are. See, yeah. But Adam was never given no Ten Commandments. Mm. You understand? He was given that one commandment. Of every tree of the garden you can freely eat, but tree of knowledge of good and evil, don't eat, for the day that you do, you'll surely die. And it wasn't until, you might as well get Genesis 3:1 first. Because it said that old serpent. But it says now has come salvation. So after he cast out those the Lucifer, Satan, the devil, and his angels, it says now has come salvation. Well, that's when salvation comes, is when demons are cast out. Mm-hmm. So you might have demons before you come in here, but the preaching of the gospel will cast demons out.
Right.
That's Mark 16:15. He said, go into this right before he ascends, go into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature. Mm-hmm. Them that believe and are baptized. When you believe the gospel, Yahshua Messiah, you can be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Right. Shall be saved.
Right.
Them that believe not shall be damned. It says, these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall you cast out demons. So demons are cast out by the preaching of the gospel in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. Okay. And you shall speak with new tongues. That's why we speak with new tongues. Mm-hmm. And it says, and you can drink deadly things, it won't kill you. You understand? You can handle serpents, they won't harm you. See, mm-hmm. What those serpents are demons. You can handle demons in bodies. They ain't going to change your mind that Yahshua is the true Savior of the world and that His Heavenly Father is Yahweh. His divine title is Elohim. You understand? They're not taking that away from you. See? But they'll try.
Yeah.
You understand? That's what his job is.
Yep.
See, okay, you got...
No, the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which Yahweh Elohim had made.
So now it says the serpent was more... This is Genesis 3:1. The serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field. Now we just read... Well, we just had in Revelation 12 that it called him the dragon. That old serpent called Satan, the devil... and that's also in Revelation 20 that we saw an angel come down having the key of bombs, the great chain in his hand, and he laid hold of that that dragon, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. So it's not a snake, it's not a serpent, a physical serpent.
Right.
But the physical serpent is a natural example to represent how the satanic spirit is. Mm-hmm. Because a serpent, well, he's cast down to the earth. You understand? He's very, he hides. You understand? And his bite, he can be poisonous with his mouth. That's what a serpent is a poisonous snake.
Right.
See, and that's how he deceived the woman, was with what he told her. Mm-hmm. See? And his tail drew a one-third part of a star. That's a lie that he told. That's not a dragon floating somewhere. In so-called heaven, and his physical tail drew one-third of the angelic host. It's a lie. And how you get that is Isaiah 9:15. It says, the ancient and honorable, he's the head. The prophet that teacheth lies is the tail. So you see how the tail is a lie? Mm-hmm. You understand? So that's his tail. He lied in the angelic realm. And how did he lie? And that's why you get Isaiah and Ezekiel. Because he was full of beauty and wisdom.
Right.
You understand? So the angels were deceived by how he looked.
Yep.
See? And he got them deceived and thinking he was the creator. You understand? And have them worship him. And then that, when Yahweh Elohim reveals unto him who he really is, then he's so powerful that his tail drew a 1/3 part of a star. Now it says he deceiveth the whole world. Mankind's no problem. If he deceived the angelic host, how is it easy for mankind to be deceived? Mm-hmm. Do you understand?
Need Isaiah.
Okay. Okay, well, I don't know. This I'm grabbing a lot of stuff here.
Right. Maybe after Isaiah 14.
Yeah, read 14 and 12.
Isaiah 14, verse 12. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer?
How are you fallen from heaven, O Lucifer?
Son of the morning.
Son of the morning.
How art thou cut down to the ground?
Yeah.
Which didst weaken the nation?
Yeah. So he's over there deceiving mankind, weakest the nation. Read.
For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven.
Now he said, I will ascend into heaven. Read.
I will exalt my throne above the stars of Elohim.
I'll exalt my throne above the stars of Elohim.
I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north.
And the sides of the north. And I was watching a thing where that Will had done in Ontario, and I thought it was a really good point. Mm-hmm. On the north side,
I will ascend above the heights of the clouds.
Hold on. You have 12 tribes around the tabernacle. And on the north side, the head tribe was Dan. Mm-hmm. Right. And Dan means judge. Mm-hmm. So when he said he would sit in the sides of the north, he's saying he's going to sit in judgment. He's going to judge you. Mm-hmm. Don't realize, you understand?
Yeah.
But you know our seventh aim, and seven denotes perfection. Yeah. Our seventh aim is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the dragon, the mm-hmm. Satan, and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Right. See, at the end of time, that's when the universal revelation is. That's when you're either going to be cast in a lake of fire with Lucifer, Satan, the devil, and his angels, and all the souls he's deceived, or you're going to be in the kingdom, being one of his angels, praising him throughout eternity. See, and that's why he's mad. Well, he's been cast down to the earth. Well, you might as well get there. Well, keep reading there. So he said he's going to sit in the sides of the north. Read.
I will ascend above the heights of the clouds.
Now, he said he's going to ascend to the heights of the cloud. You ever read in, when you go to this tabernacle?
Above.
In Leviticus 16 and 2, Yahweh said he will dwell in the cloud between the wings of the cherubims upon the mercy seat. So when the devil said he's going to ascend above the heights of the cloud, that means he's going higher than Yahweh.
Yep.
That's the creature trying to be like the Creator. You understand? It's his exaltation. He's so beautiful and wise that he decided I'm the one.
Yeah.
You understand?
Yeah.
Read on.
I will be like the Most High.
Now see, right here, Yahweh, when he asked him, Moses asked him, What is your name? In Exodus 3:13, he told him he was Ayah, Asher, Ayah. I will be what I will to be. That's Exodus 3:14. And what does the devil say? I will be like the Most High. In other words, I will be.
Yeah.
See, Yahweh said, I will be what I will to be. But then the devil said, I will be too.
Mm-hmm.
You understand? When he's really the creature.
Right.
See, and that's really what the whole thing is. All you got's the Creator and the created. And the devil's got you worshiping the created instead of the Creator. And that's the difference in this school. We have this divine vision revelation. We learn that, you're learning how to worship Yahweh in spirit and in truth.
Right.
It's by divine vision revelation. You're being taught by the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
See? And the Holy Spirit's going to cast out those demons that are in your mind by the preaching of the gospel, the good news. When you get knowledge, the darkness goes. You understand? When you learn something, you know that that ignorance is gone from that part.
Mm-hmm.
But there's we don't even know how much ignorance we got.
Yeah.
But there'll be a time that when them demons are cast out, you can be sealed with the Holy Spirit. That's what Ephesians 1:13 says. In whom also you trusted. After that you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. After you believe, you're sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise.
Mm-hmm.
See, and that's what the power of this gospel is. See, you can be sealed with the Holy Spirit when you believe it. Mm-hmm. See, but it has to be taught correctly. Yeah. You understand? So this is one of the biggest. So, well, I'm kind of going into two questions because she asked about the demons and then you asked about the law. Okay?
Right.
Now, one time Dr. Kinley called this a law of carnal ordinance because it was a physical tree. You understand? And he told them, don't eat it. But they weren't the carnal ordinances that you have under the law. See, there's a whole age here where they weren't even given the Ten Commandments. Mm-hmm. So they have, you have a whole age where they weren't given the Ten Commandments and the carnal ordinances. Then this age, that's the, which is the post-diluvian age, that's when they were given the law of carnal ordinances. And Dr. Kinley said, why did they give them carnal ordinances? To go along with the carnal mind they got from their father Adam.
Mm-hmm.
See, when she was deceived, she ate, gave to her husband, he did eat. And to show the change that took place, they were in the garden naked and not ashamed. But after they ate, they was naked, they was ashamed. He's hiding from Yahweh, he's afraid of Yahweh. You understand? Mm-hmm. So that's showing the change that was in his mind. Before he wasn't, see, but now he's hiding. You understand? And he had to cover his nakedness.
Right.
And the scripture lesson talks about we're all naked to whom we have to do. We're mm-hmm. Yahweh. You know, he's, in other words, you're open to him. You ain't like hiding from him.
Yeah.
You understand why? Because he's in you.
Mm-hmm.
He's ever present. That's how he can judge you. See, that's what makes him a righteous judge. The eyes of Yahweh is in every place beholding the good and evil. See, there ain't nothing you're going to pull one on him, see, thinking you're his, right? Okay, so that's why he gave him those carnal ordinances. So, okay, so he said, I will be like the Most High. Now, there really ain't nothing like him, because that's in Isaiah 46:5. He said, who will you liken me that we may be equal?
Yeah.
Who you going to liken Yahweh to? You can't. He's the creator. He's the one that made everything. So that's the difference. He, the satanic spirit, he's the... Oh, he got it right there. See, I will be what I will to be in Exodus 3:14. And here's Isaiah 14:14. I'll be like the Most High.
Right.
See, and he's a liar. You understand? Mm-hmm. There's only one. And if he said there's none like me, and who you going to make look like to be equal? And he's got that in two places. Well, there's a bunch of plays, not more than two. But two I can remember right now. In Isaiah 45:5, he says, I'm Yahweh, and there's none else. I'm Yahweh, there's no Elohim beside me. And some people try to make the mistake of saying that Yahweh and the devil are equal.
Hmm.
You know, that Yahweh is the devil. And I know some people that say the devil's got the Holy Spirit.
What?
I mean, because everything's Yahweh. So if Yahweh's a unity, you can't break up the unity of the Spirit, so the devil got the Holy Spirit.
He'll say anything.
Anyway, there's a difference between the creature and the creator. And
right.
The devil's got you worshiping him or worshiping something other than the creator. Worship the created instead of the creator, like we talked about. He also has you trying to... in other words, you're creature serving. You're serving yourself instead of the Creator. You understand? You're carnal minded. You worry about what other people think and don't worry about what Yahweh thinks about you. You understand? See, there's all kind of factors involved. Okay, I better hurry up because I don't want to spend all the time. Did we finish that? 14:14. I'll be like the Most High. What else is there?
Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell.
Yeah.
To the side of the pit.
That's right.
They that see thee shall narrowly look upon thee.
Yeah.
And consider made the earth to be tremble.
And you know that happens to us. You read in the Bible about Mystery Babylon. You know, we were in the Mystery Babylon, but it was a mystery to us. It wasn't until we were brought into this teaching that we could be brought out of that, and we're looking back and say, I can't believe I was deceived that bad. How could I have been that stupid? You understand? But if you don't have a divine vision revelation, all you can do is be deceived. You understand? You just don't know. And it's like what we say. We didn't know that we didn't know.
Right.
You understand? And when you don't know that you don't know, you don't know. And so somebody that does know has to tell you. You don't know. Eternal life's to know too. John 17:3. And so his job is to keep people ignorant.
Right.
You understand? And that's the whole problem. I mean, look how many people use the Lord God and Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. That don't make sense. But the devil's very good at deceiving. Got you. They got them believing in Jesus Christ when there never could have been a man called Jesus 2,000 years ago. Never. No J. Call him Jesus. He's a born Hebrew. No J in the Hebrew alphabet. Impossible to be Jesus. But that don't mean nothing to them. I still love my Jesus. Why are you trying to tell me? You understand? And all I have to do is the same research we did.
That's right.
But that's how powerful demons are. I mean, they're so powerful. We used to see people. Matter of fact, when I came into school in I came in 1986. A lot of people come in earlier than that. You got two people here already early. Well, anyway. And you know what he said? He said, wherever you see these charts, you're going to hear the same thing.
Mm.
It was a unity. Mm-hmm. You understand? We were saying the same thing. I heard them preach blood, water, spirit, 40, death, burial, resurrection, gospels, Yahshua Messiah, the death, burial, resurrection, ascension, power, Holy Spirit. And now they say Dr. Kinley's your Savior and Heavenly Father. That's crazy.
Yep.
What's the power that caused them to turn like that and believe false doctrine? Demons. You understand? He ain't stopped. He don't care what lie you believe, as long as you believe in one. And he came into the school, and 100 schools believe that stuff and watch videotape, and it's just worse. It's just bad. But that's showing you how much power that satanic spirit has.
That's right.
See, and that's why you want to be in school. That's what his last lecture was. Come to class. Be on time. Try to learn all you can possibly learn. Try to understand all you can possibly understand, because you need it to keep you steadfast and not be removed from the faith.
That's right.
See, and then he did say, now they like to quote the December, that's December 21, 1975. December 3rd, 1975, he talks about erroneous doctrine. And he said, if I say it's erroneous, it's erroneous. And he talks about the gospel being the death, burial, resurrection of Yahshua Messiah. How he raised again. He says, now the reason why you believe the gospel, because you can't refute it. You can't go against the gospel. I mean, you understand? In other words, you can't disprove it. You can disagree, but you ain't disproving it. See, and then what he told him, he said, now they like to say, well, he said he wasn't kicking about false doctrine.
That's right.
He did say that. But they never finish it. he said he wasn't kicking about false. He knew the devil's going to come up and lie.
Right. That's right.
He said, he ain't kicking about false doctrine. He said, but I want you to be prepared to reject it when it does come, so that your soul be saved. Yeah. That's what he said.
Yeah. No,
then they say, you know, there ain't no soul salvation. That's crazy.
That's why they don't finish it.
Yeah, right. That's why they don't finish it. So you just become ignorant and stupid. But that's why we tell you to read the thing.
Right.
This is a school. What school you go, you don't learn nothing. And we've heard a girl get up. Matter of fact, we was in a class, and Valerie ran truth, law, prize, fulfillment, spirit fulfillment. I'm over there finishing up, preaching the gospel and showing Yahshua before, you know, because in the Elohim book, well, I don't know why I'm going off on this, but anyway, I don't want to take all the time here. But anyway, and I won't. on the Elohim book, on the front page, you got two scriptures. You got Isaiah 57:15. It says, golly, I forget now. Then you have
Micah 5:2.
Micah 5:2.
And have it eternity.
Yeah, yeah.
It's the end of the one that is eternity.
Yahweh said, I'm the high and lofty one whose name is holy, and he inhabits eternity. That's where he lives. He's eternal. You understand? Then Micah 5:2 says, Bethlehem Ephratah, though thou be little among the thousands of Judah, out of thee shall come forth the ruler of Israel. See, and then it says, whose going forth
has been from
everlasting.
From old and from everlasting.
From old time unto everlasting.
Right.
So that's talking about Yahshua Messiah. He's from everlasting.
Yeah.
See, there ain't nobody teaching like that. They think he come through the loins of the Virgin Mary. You understand? That's the first time he ever showed up. That's why they don't understand how he died, buried, and resurrected again. Okay? So, get to Ezekiel 28 and 12. Read that.
Ezekiel 28.
So what his job is, Yahweh said, don't eat.
Right.
He says, eat. Yahweh said, you'll surely die. He said, you won't die. So, you know, so what, and I believe devil means opposer. That's what it means. So that's really what he does. He opposes. Whatever Yahweh said, he's going to say the opposite. Just like it never rained before. And Noah's vision is it's going to rain. What's the devil going to tell you? It ain't going to rain. Don't get no ark. That's stupid. You understand? Then when the rain come, he found out it was true.
Too late.
You understand? But it's too late.
Right.
See? And even when Abraham and Sarah, when they were told they were going to have a child, they said, oh, it ain't going to. Oh, she laughed. He laughed too.
That's right.
But she said, why'd she laugh? This time next year, you're going to have a baby. You understand? See? Anyway, and that's Yahweh. What are all those barren women opening up their wombs so they can have children? It's showing that before you come into the school, you were barren. You couldn't have no spiritual fruit because you didn't even know the truth. But now you can bring forth spiritual offspring. You can bring forth, you can have his son, Yahshua Messiah, in you. You understand? And that's what Paul says in 4:19 of Galatians. I travail in birth again till the Messiah be formed in you.
Mm-hmm.
See? Okay, read Ezekiel 28:12.
Son of man, take up a lamentation upon the king of Tyrus.
Yeah.
And say unto him, thus saith,
and you know what Tyrus means? It means rock. He's saying he's a king of rock.
Yeah.
Yahshua said he's a rock. I mean, matter of fact, that's what Deuteronomy 32:4 says. See, it says 32:4. Man, I don't know where I'm having a mental block here. It says he is our rock. His work is perfect. See, he is a rock.
His work is perfect.
Yeah.
For all his ways are judgment.
All his ways are judgment.
An Elohim of truth.
He's an Elohim of truth.
And without iniquity.
Without iniquity.
Just and right is he.
Just and right is he. Okay. So he's the rock, but here's the devil. I'm king of rock. I'm the rock. You understand? He's a liar. You understand? But that's and it seems like he's a. Well, you better get the. Well, anyway. In Exodus 9:16, Yahweh tells Pharaoh, in this very deed that I raise you up. Now why'd he raise up Pharaoh? Because he'd already raised up the satanic spirit from the angelic realm to see the man. You know, he got raised up and he got cast out. See, so here Pharaoh, he's getting raised up. He said, in this very deed have I raised you up, that I might show forth my power, and that my name may be declared throughout all earth. They all knew about Yahweh after he tore him down. You understand?
Sure.
Matter of fact, when they went up there, he said, we've heard about you. That's why, you know, it stopped Rachel from being a whore. And she's helping out the spies. You know, she didn't stay a whore. You understand? People don't
realize
that.
That's right. That's right.
There's a change that takes place.
Yeah.
And that's what happens to us. We can be all messed up before we come down here. And you can be messed up while you're here. But then if he cleans you up, gives you the Holy Spirit, you're a new creature in the Messiah.
Yeah.
You understand? That's the hope.
Sure.
I mean, that's what we preach. We're preaching life after death. And we were all carnal minded.
Yeah.
See, that's what he said. When the day truth up, you'll surely die. And they did die. They became carnal minded. They died in their mind. And Yahshua Messiah was crucified in Golgotha, which means place of skull. But he was also buried in the same place. He also resurrected.
Mm-hmm.
You understand? Showing that he can resurrect you in your skull. Okay, keep reading.
Thus saith Yahweh Elohim, thou sealest up the sum, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty.
Yeah, so he ain't talking about the king. It's showing the satanic spirit that's in him.
Mm-hmm. Right.
At the time.
Right.
See, it's talking about the end. In the end, he was full of wisdom and beauty. That's right. How he was able to trick them. That's how beautiful he was.
Right.
And that's what they also say about, that's the vision and revelation. Dr. Kinley said that. See, when he appeared to that woman, that just fooled her. You understand? She'd never seen nothing that beautiful. Compared to Adam, there was no comparison. Even though he's cast out and he's a higher form of creation, the angelic is. Yeah. Read on. Even though he's cast the earth and he's in hell spiritually. Read.
Full of wisdom, perfect in beauty, thou hast been in Eden, the garden of Elohim.
He was in Eden, the garden. That Prince Tyrus wasn't there, or the King of Tyrus wasn't there, but the satanic spirit was.
Right.
You read about that old serpent, right? Read.
Every precious
it
stone.
It said what Yahweh Elohim made, too. So it's showing that he was made by the Creator. Read.
Every precious stone was thy covering.
Yeah.
The sardis, the topaz, the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, the jasper, the sapphire.
Yeah.
The emerald and the carbuncle and gold.
Now see, he's got nine stones to show.
Mm-hmm.
See, Yahweh has nine attributes.
That's right.
In the spirit.
That's right.
The devil isn't made from different spirit. You understand? But it's what it is a corruption of it.
That's right.
See, what he does is have it worship him. He worships himself instead of, you understand? In other words, that's what his job is. It's an inward thing instead of seeing the Creator. Or, in other words, you're giving yourself praises instead of him. You understand?
Yeah.
But you were created. Angels were created to serve, honor, obey, and glorify Yahweh. That's really what we're created for.
Right.
Is to serve, honor, obey, and glorify Yahweh. But the devil's got us honor and obeying and serving and glorifying each other or the world or whatever. Whatever we're into.
Mm-hmm.
See?
Yep.
See? We talk about carnal ordinances. Well, them guys down the bar have a carnal ordinance. They want to drink rum all day. You understand? Who's telling them to drink rum all day? That's the devil. You understand? I mean, Rastafarian saying that all the life is just the physical. You know, that was one of the things in the school. A Rastafari one time, we had an outdoor lecture, and the guy goes, if you can show me anything that's not made from the earth, I'll give you my car. And Rohan pointed up to the sun. That wasn't made from the earth. And the guy didn't give him the car. You understand?
Liar.
And they think that if you die, means you didn't live right on the earth.
Mm-hmm.
Well, everybody dies. Matter of fact, the atheists, they say they don't believe in the Creator. Well, it's in the Bible. It's appointed man wants to die. Now, don't they die?
Yeah.
Defy Yahweh.
Yeah. Yeah.
Since there ain't no Creator. You going to do that?
No,
that's the devil's job, has got you believing there's, in other words, you're a supreme carnal minded. All you can think is the physical when you're out like that. You don't see the Creator.
Mm-hmm.
You're out there thinking Haile Selassie's still living somewhere in the cave. You understand? Because he's the ultimate Selassie-eye. The I and I. You ought to come and get the Y and the Y.
That's right.
Yahweh and Yahshua.
That's right.
Yeah.
No I thing. See how the devil always got you looking at, you know, yourself.
Right.
See,
yeah.
And then be humble. Yes, Empress. You know, I've seen them guys. The guy's crazy, but you know they do act like they humble. You know what I'm saying? Okay, keep reading.
The workmanship of thy tabrets and thy pipes were prepared in thee. In the day that thou was created.
In the day. See, when Yahweh created everything, it was done in the day of eternity, in the realm of eternity. That's when he was created. Read.
Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth, and I have set thee so.
He was the anointed cherub that covereth, and he set him so. Read.
I was in the holy mountain of Elohim.
Mm-hmm.
Thou walkest up and down in the midst of the stones of fire.
Yeah, mm-hmm. he was all up around all the other angels. Read.
Thou was prepared in thy ways from the day that thou was created.
See,
till iniquity was found in
him. He was prepared in the days he was created until iniquity was found in him. Read on.
By the multitude of thy merchandise, they have filled the midst of thee.
And you know how he showed the merchandise? See, carnal ordinances are merchandise, and he's rich in those merchandise, ain't he? Tell him you need to be water baptized, eat the Lord's Supper, pay tithes and offerings, and if you're a Muslim, pray five times a day. You understand? Fast in Ramadan, make the Hajj one time in your life. Those are all carnal things. See?
Right.
And it, and you know, some people, a lot of people like to say, well, if I'm just a good person, God will save me. Then why'd the Savior die? We ain't telling you to be evil. But I'll tell you this, why'd he come and die if you can be a good person and be saved? See, it don't even make sense to pay money to be saved, because why'd he die if I gotta pay money to be saved now? Wasn't no reason for him to die, he's a fool. Because I can pay money and be saved. I can join the church and be water baptized, eat Lord's Supper. Keep the Sabbath day, huh? No, it don't make sense. But that's how good the devil is. Now, all of us was taught like that. You know what I'm saying? I mean, we were all taught some false thing.
Right.
Read on.
By the multitude of thy merchandise, they have filled the midst of thee with violence.
With violence.
And thou hast sinned.
He had sinned. Now, sin is the transgression of the law, so there has to be a law. Then there's a sin, and in his, and that he's the man of sin.
Right.
So he causes you to transgress the law. See, and where you find out sin is the transgression of the law, that's 1 John 3:4.
Right.
And you know what 3:8 says? Whoever sinneth is of the devil. And you know, people like to do that. I was in a Baptist church where the guy said, I've got the Holy Spirit, but I'm a sinner. And I'm thinking, wait a minute. You just said the Holy Spirit's a sinner. He said, what happens is, but see, the sin's what holding the Holy Spirit back. You know, that's messed up.
Oh,
but anyway, you just have all kind of thoughts.
Yeah.
But I think that's...
And thou hast sinned. Therefore I will cast thee as profane out of the mouth.
Now that's
of
the whole point. If you have sin, it's... Whenever you see sin in the Bible, it was cast out.
Yes.
Like when they built this... Well... Keep reading.
And I will cast thee as profane out of the mountain of Elohim, and I will destroy thee, O covering cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire.
Yeah.
Thy heart was lifted up because of thy beauty.
Okay.
Thou hast corrupted thy wisdom by the reason of thy brightness.
All right, so to answer the question, I wanted to show that you have a opposing force. You understand? That's trying to corrupt, trying to, whenever you have the truth preached to you, he's trying to tell you, no, it ain't that way. You understand? Don't believe them names. You understand? Or whatever. Somebody tells you, you know, that's why in this school, he said he had a divine vision revelation, Dr. Kinley. He said, don't believe me, make me prove it. You understand? Now, who else has told you, don't believe me, but make me prove it? Nobody. Because they can't. They don't have no witnesses. They don't have no divine vision revelation. See? Okay. I'm going to have to fast forward now. So, you can see that down through the dispensations, Yahweh would tell them, don't eat. They ate. They broke the, that was the Adamic covenant, and it was broken. You understand? See? And that brought death unto all mankind. That's Romans 5:12. Wherefore, as by one man, sin entered into the world. And it was really, and it says in 1 Timothy 2:14, he says, Adam wasn't deceived, but the woman being deceived was in the transgression.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what? People read that and say, see, Adam didn't transgress. It doesn't say that. It said he wasn't deceived.
Right.
Right.
You understand? Yahweh said, don't eat. He ate.
That's right. That's transgression.
And matter of fact, Dr. Kinley called him a confess sinner.
Right.
Because in 3:12, he said, the woman, she ate and gave it to me, and I did eat. So he said, I'm a sinner.
Right.
Because Yahweh said, don't eat. So if he ate, but what it was to bring everything down, see, and everybody was dead and buried for 4,033 years there in darkness. But he would give people the Holy Spirit for a little while to prophesy and do what Yahweh wanted man to do. Mm-hmm. You understand? That's how our book got written by divine. That's how the Bible got written by divine vision revelation. See, now, he gave Noah a covenant. They wasn't going to destroy the world again by water. But what happened? They built a Tower of Babel. You know what I'm saying? What's down here? They built a Tower of Babel. Now, so you got the Edenic transgression. You got the flood. You got the Tower of Babel. See? And Yahweh destroyed all them people that didn't believe the vision. You understand?
Right. Mm-hmm.
And there was violence in the earth. It said the heart and mind was, in Genesis 6 and 5, it says the heart and mind of man was only evil continuously.
The imagination of man's heart was only evil continually.
So it's showing the after the death of Adam, how man was buried in condemnation and wickedness. You understand?
Mm-hmm.
And then Yahweh had a flood, but if they got in the ark, they resurrected and come on over. Okay? Then right here, you got the Abrahamic promise. Now that's very important right there.
Yeah.
See, he gave Abraham a promise that he would bless his seed as the stars of the heaven and the sands of the sea.
Right.
See, and he said, but first they have to go down and be evilly treated. He was up here, and he tells them that the seed have to come down. And that's when they were in bondage. He said, and it'll be a people of bondage. He says, but I will bring them out, and I will judge that people and bring them out with great substance. And that's what he did. They had so much substance. They were slaves. By the time they left out, they was rich, and they was able, you understand? And they used the substance to make this tabernacle.
Right.
But they also used the substance to make a golden calf. See?
Substance abuse.
Yeah, that's substance abuse. Taking gold and wasting it on a golden calf.
Right.
You understand? And really, if you don't worship the Creator in spirit and truth in this age, that's substance abuse.
Yeah.
See? And He'll destroy you for that.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, this old covenant, see, or this, then after the promise, 430 years after the promise, that's when Yahweh brought the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, right? He gave them the Passover feast. They were, that's Exodus 12. They set up time. April is the first month of the year. April 14th, that's baptism being set up with a group of people. Singing songs in Exodus 15. Exodus 16 was the Sabbath day given. Exodus 20 is the Ten Commandment law. Okay? And then after he spoke the law down in Exodus 19, 16 through 18 and 19, 20, I mean, Exodus 20. After he spoke the law down 50 some days later, that's when they built a golden calf. So they broke the law, Yahweh, and that's one of the Ten Commandments. That was Yahweh that gave them that commandment, and they broke it. Matter of fact, that's what he called the first church.
Yeah.
Because they were all assembled around the mount, and who was the speaker?
Yahweh.
You understand? And he's introducing himself. Moses said, Yahweh's the one that come and brought you out. Now he said, I'm the one that brought you up out of the land of Egypt.
Right.
So Yahweh was introducing himself, but it still didn't. That shows you how powerful the devil is. Yahweh's the speaker, and they're out there transgressing what Yahweh just told them. Huh? So what do you think they're going to do to us? They didn't believe the Messiah. They nailed him to the cross. See, what do you think they're going to do? They're not going to believe you neither, because you got this. You're the same teaching. You understand?
Yep.
It's the same teaching. So he gave them. So what Yahweh did, he gave mankind 4,033 years to keep his law, and they couldn't keep it. That's what you read about the Bible. He gave them 613 laws and ordinances. The first Sabbath day that he gave in Exodus 16, you had people look. They were told to take out, get the bread for 6 days. On the sixth day, get twice as much, and don't be out there on the seventh day. You read the seventh day they was out there looking for. First Sabbath, they have done broken already. You understand? And that's why in Exodus 20 and 7, it says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. See? And see, if you broke the Sabbath, you had to be stoned to death. How many people work out on Saturdays? They'd all have to be stoned if the law was still in.
Yeah.
You understand?
Right.
If you blasphemed his name, you got stoned to death. That's under the old covenant. So they're out there saying they're keeping the Ten Commandments law, then why don't you use Yahweh then? Because that's what he told them. He said, Yahweh, that's my name forever and immortal throughout all generations. The third commandment in Exodus 20 and 7 says, thou shalt not take the name of Yahweh thy Elohim in vain, for I'm not only guilty to take his name in vain. Do you know what vain means in Hebrew? It means to falsify or substitute. So when you don't use his name,
right,
you're falsifying and substituting. And you know, when we used to tell people the name in the early years, they'd say, it isn't about the name, it's the character. And you know, that's what that's what the Los Angeles school and all the people that believe their doctrine believes.
Yeah.
I was in Spanish Town, and I was talking about it. We don't call them headquarters no more. We call them hindquarters, because you know it comes out of hindquarters. It don't matter. You know what they said? It ain't headquarters, it's dead quarters. Because they're dead up there. And they're preaching false doctrine. You understand?
Right.
And we tell the truth. See, we're telling you the truth, trying to help you out of it. You understand? You shouldn't be in it, really. You shouldn't be listening to that. But that's how powerful that satanic spirit is. See, so that old covenant is 613 laws, Lord. They couldn't keep it. So, and then Yahweh, okay, watch now. He only gave the law to the Israelites and the Israelites alone. If you were not an Israelite, the law wasn't ever given to you, the 613 ordinances. That's what people don't realize. It wasn't ever given to you. See, and they couldn't keep it. Now, you read in Jeremiah 31:31. See, they've been having that law for almost 900 years.
Right.
And it says, behold, the days come, saith Yahweh. So Yahweh speaking, that I'll make a new covenant with the house of Israel, house of Judah. Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt. So they had the Passover feast. Not going to be like that one, because he said he's going to make a new one, not like that. That was the beginning of water baptism. You understand? With a group of people. He ain't going to make it again like that. Sabbath day. He ain't going to make it again like that. Ten Commandments is under that. Behold, the days come, save Yahweh, that I'll make a new covenant with the house of Israel, house of Judah. Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant break all as a husband unto this, save Yahweh. But this shall be the covenant I will make with them after those days. After what days? After the days this Yahshua Messiah comes in on the airplane through the loins of Virgin Mary. See, in Hebrews 10:9, it said he taketh away the first that he may establish the second. So when we have him fulfilling, fulfill means to finish, complete, bring to an end. He said, after those days, saith Yahweh, and that's after Yahshua is born. He goes into his ministry. He lives three and a half years. He lives 33 and a half years and dies. Buries, resurrects, ascends, and pours out the Holy Spirit. See, that brought in the new covenant when he poured out the Holy Spirit. That brought in a new age. It's completely different from what the age was before. So, he it tells you, now right here, if you just read this right here, Acts 2:39 and Galatians 3-6, it almost answers your question about the law too. See, but I will say this. After he fulfills it, when he's in the physical body, he did do physical things. But see, now that he's died, buried, resurrected, and that's why Hebrews 6 says that leaving the principles of the doctrine of the Messiah, let's go on to perfection. It talks about dead works. Why is it dead? Because when that physical body did it, and he died, it died with him. You understand? And Colossians 2:14, it says, blotting out the handwriting of ordinance which was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. See?
Yeah.
So when he nailed it to the cross, and then that body was buried, that's when those carnal ordinances were buried. And when he resurrected a quickening spirit. That's why things are spirit. Spirit is required on this side of the cross. He gave the natural to testify the spirit. So he said, I'll put my law, after those days, saith Yahweh, I'll put my law in their inward. He said he put his law. Mm-hmm. What did they say? Ten Commandment laws I got to keep. He said he put his law in the inward part. What is the law? That's the law of the spirit of life. That's what he says in Romans 8:2. For the law of the spirit of life in Yahshua Messiah hath made me free from the law of sin and death. And in Romans 8:1, it says, Therefore, there is no condemnation to them that are in Yahshua Messiah. See, after he died, buried, resurrected, and poured out the Holy Spirit, you no more can, if you receive the Holy Spirit, you're not in condemnation no more. And he'd ask him, well, how do I get in Yahshua Messiah? Said, the law of the spirit of life in Yahshua Messiah made me free from the law of sin and death. See, that's what this was. This was a law of sin and death, because when Adam died, when he sinned, he died in his consciousness. This was the law of sin and death. When you sin, either a sacrifice died in your place or you died. That was the law of sin and death. But Yahshua Messiah, he died to put an end to sin. You understand? Died, buried, resurrected, ascended, and poured out the Holy Spirit. That brings in the new covenant. So he said, I put my law in their inward parts. And that's why you got two tables of stone back here. The first table of stone, when they built the golden calf, he threw those tables of stone and broke them. Then he had to bring up a second table of stone. And then Yahweh wrote on those. And that's like it unto him. You come into class and he's writing it in your heart and mind.
Right.
He's writing it in your heart and mind. You understand? That's the way the gospel is now. See, or that's the covenant now. And when he came down to the second table of stone, that second table of stone was put in the Ark of the Covenant,
right,
showing forth the new covenant placed in the heart and mind of mankind. Now, when Yahshua Messiah, but it had to be fulfilled first. Before you can bring in a new one, you have to get rid of the old one. Mm-hmm. So Yahshua Messiah, that's why he said in John 3, 15, he says, thus, suffer to be so now, John, for thus becometh us to fulfill all righteousness.
Matthew 3:15.
Yeah. I'm sorry. Come to fulfill all righteousness. Now, you know another thing you'll see there? Well, I tell you, I get caught up in all this stuff. I got to move. So, you know, in Matthew 3:13, it says, then cometh Yahshua unto Galilee, unto Jordan, to be baptized. Why is he coming from Galilee? Because it's a three-day journey to the River Jordan to show that he's fulfilling the three-day journey from the children of Israel to be water baptized back there in Egypt. See, but anyway, he says, and John says, well, I need to be come to you, because they were confessing their sins, and Yahshua didn't have no sins to confess. I need to be baptized you. Why are you coming to me? And that's when he said, in John and Matthew 3:15, thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. Well, what's the righteous he's fulfilling? The righteous under the law. That's Deuteronomy 6:24-25. If we would do all these things, it will be our righteousness. And you know what it says in Isaiah 64:6? It says, all our righteousnesses are as filthy rags. That was the righteous that was under the law. That's right. So Yahshua Messiah come to fulfill it, see. And so in Matthew 5, and he said to one person, he came to fulfill all rights. And that us is Yahweh Elam Yahshua in that body. That's the us, the same us that say, let us make man our image and likeness. Not John and Yahshua. Right. Okay. Then in Matthew 5:17-18 says, think not that I've come to destroy the law of the prophets. And that's what he's got written up there. Think not I've come to destroy the law of the prophets. I've not come to destroy, but to fulfill. Till heaven and earth pass, not one jot or one tittle shall no wise pass the law, till all be fulfilled. All means everything, don't it? If he said he come to fulfill all things, and what age, and he's under the dispensation of law, he had to fulfill the entire covenant. See, then after his death, burial, resurrection, in Luke 24:44, these are the words I spake with you while I was yet with you, that all things must. That means you can't have some. See, if you got the Ten Commandments still, that's some. That's not all. You understand? And I'll tell you where you get all the Ten Commandments at, that he fulfilled them.
Yeah.
That's in Ephesians 2, and there's a lot there in Ephesians 2. Matter of fact, Ephesians 2:1 says, you hath he quickened, who were once dead in trespasses and sins. So what he's saying is, you were dead.
Yep.
But he says, and you hath he quickened. That's what this gospel does, is quicken you. It resurrects you.
Yeah.
When we preach the resurrection of Yahshua, we're talking about him being resurrected in your heart and mind. Then you'd be led of the Spirit.
Right.
See, And so, and it talks a whole bunch of stuff who were dead and trespassed in, but I can't get it all there.
15 says, I've been abolished in his flesh.
Is that 2 and 11 or 14?
11, 15, that's.
Yeah, start 10. Let's see.
For we are his workmen created in Yahshua the Messiah.
We are his workmanship created in Yahshua the Messiah. See?
Unto good works.
See, that's what, when he says, the law of the spirit of life in Yahshua Messiah made me free from the law of sin and death. Well, how'd you get in Yahshua Messiah? That's 1 Corinthians 12:13. For by one spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether it be Jew or Gentile, bond or free, all been made to drink into one spirit. So the baptism spirit and the drinking spirit, see? Mm-hmm. Okay, keep reading, please. We are his workmanship in Yahshua Messiah.
Created in...
Yeah.
In Yahshua the Messiah. We are his workmanship created in Yahshua the Messiah.
And, and right here, 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, if any man be in the Messiah, he's a new creature. See, created in Yahshua Messiah, new creature in the Messiah. Old things are passed away. That was that. Those things under the old covenant. All things are become new. And also the same way you're thinking, when you're carnal minded, those things pass away and you become spiritually minded. See, read.
Unto good works, which Yahweh had before ordained that we should walk in them.
Yeah.
Wherefore, remember that ye being in time past heathens in the flesh.
You were heathens in the flesh. We were Gentiles. We were never given the law. Mm-hmm. Read.
Who called uncircumcision by that which is called.
You were called uncircumcision. But you know what? There's a circumcision of the heart. And that's what he says in Jeremiah 9th chapter, right at the end of it.
Yeah.
He says, I'm going to punish the circumcised with the uncircumcision.
That's right.
And he says, and Israel is uncircumcised in their heart.
Right.
They've been physically circumcised, but they were spiritually, mm-hmm. they were uncircumcised.
Right.
Read.
By that which is called the circumcision in the flesh made by hands.
In the flesh by hands. Read.
That at that time ye were without the Messiah, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel.
Yeah, before they didn't even know, they didn't have to keep no commandments or nothing. You was without the Messiah in the world. Mm-hmm. You was out Yahweh in the world. Read.
And aliens from the commonwealth of Israel.
Yeah, you were aliens. You were different from, that's what we're called. We're called aliens when we come to Jamaica, because we're not from Jamaica. Read.
And strangers from the covenant of promise.
Strangers from the covenant of promise. Read.
Having no hope.
We had no hope.
And without Elohim in the world.
We weren't even in the picture until after he died, buried, resurrected, poured out the Holy Spirit. Then we had to wait 7 years. Read.
But now in Yahshua the Messiah.
But now in Yahshua the Messiah.
He who were formerly were far off.
Yeah.
Are made nigh by the blood of the Messiah.
See? He died for all mankind. Read. He died
for... For he is our peace.
It said he died for our sins according to the scriptures. He's our peace. Read.
Who had made both one and had broken down the middle wall of partition between us.
What's the middle wall?
Law.
See, that's the law. It ain't how you spell wall. If you read back, if you do it right to left like Hebrew does, you'd have law there. So that wall, the law, that was what separated the Israelite from the non-Israelite, was the law. So when he fulfilled it all, nailed it to the cross, died and was buried, when he resurrects a quickening spirit, see, that's when he's going to make one. So that's what it's talking about there. He broke down the middle wall partition. That's when he fulfilled the law and nailed it to the cross, took it out of the way. And you know what? Right here, Hebrews 9:10. It says that the law didn't help nobody as pertaining to their conscience. But Hebrews 9:10, it says, which stood only, that old covenant stood only in meats, drinks, diverse washings, and carnal ordinances imposed on them. You know, when he says that, he's talking to Hebrews. He didn't say imposed on us.
That's right.
He says it was imposed on them. In a different age, a different dispensation. Mm-hmm. You understand? So when you read in the Bible, it says that it stood only, this old covenant stood only in meats and drinks and diverse washings and carnal ordinances imposed on them. You know, the dean in Springfield, he likes to say impose. You know, if somebody comes over,
yeah,
and they eating your food all day, you understand? Mm-hmm. And they're messing with you. You want to go to bed, and you're going, and they still won't go. They've imposed themselves on you. You want them to leave. Hey, you need to go. I'm about ready to go to my bed. Why don't you leave? You understand? So they, this law, these old, this Ten Commandment law, and the sacrifice. And if you're keeping any of that, you need to be offering up sacrifices. They don't do that, do they? They just pick and choose things. See, keep reading.
Having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments,
even the law of commands
in ordinances
contained the law of commandments contained in ordinances. That includes the Ten Commandment law there. And there's so many scriptures for this,
right,
that time will not allow. I've already blown it up. I gotta leave because we got Dr. Will Williams here, and he needs to give his input. See, and ten and four. So they're going to talk about Ten Commandments, but they don't keep it themselves because they're taking his name in vain. They don't believe Yahweh, Elam, Yahshua. You understand? Mm-hmm. It's just their idea of what they're supposed to do. They're supposed to try to do something. But Yahshua did all the work. You understand?
Yeah.
See, so we believe that he did everything. That's why we run everything, law, prophets, fulfillment, and show that it was fulfilled, and then show the spiritual reality on this side of the cross. Mm-hmm. See, they believe in going to church. He says, 1 Timothy 2:5, it says, you also as lively stones are made up a spiritual house, mm-hmm, offering up spiritual sacrifices unto Messiah. And then this Galatians 6:8, they that sow to the flesh, mm-hmm, shall reap the flesh, mm-hmm, but they that sow to the Spirit shall reap the Spirit. And that's why we come to class. We're sowing to the Spirit, mm-hmm, and you're going to reap the Spirit things. See, and then in Romans 14:17, it says, the kingdom of Yahweh is not eating and drinking, but it's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Now, what we've done, we've been in this Colossians 1:13 says, in whom also you trust, or no, it didn't. It says, he hath delivered us from darkness and hath translated us into the kingdom,
right,
of his dear Son. See, when the Holy Spirit's poured out, you're in the kingdom. And look, don't tell me you're in the kingdom, you don't know the king's name. The king's name is Yahshua. You understand? See, and neither is there salvation in the other.
Right.
So don't come on this side and out there saying you're keeping the commandments. You understand? He said worship in spirit and truth, and none of them are worshiping in spirit and truth, are they? So what happens is, if you've received the Holy Spirit in this age, you're going to get an immortal, glorified body to go with it in the next age. That's the kingdom and immortality, where you receive a spirit body, and you'll be one of his angels throughout eternity. See? And you really have to be obedient to the spirit law. See, if they didn't keep this law, they died physically. You call Yahshua the Messiah a liar and say he didn't fulfill, you'll go to the lake for that. You understand? That's serious stuff. So that's a short answer to that. Because you know, because we could be here, that kind of talk, I mean, we can be in that for, I don't know how long, but I'm going to have to turn it over to, I guess, Dr. Will Williams.
That's right.
Praise Yahshua Messiah. If you want more proof, which I know there's more coming. I'm going to prophesy.
I have no idea what time it is. Is it still morning?
12:22.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
First of all, I want to say it's indeed an honor and a privilege to come back here to Mile Gully and visit the brethren here. Mm-hmm. It's been great. I appreciate the first speaker. I felt what he gave was a truly comprehensive answer. Okay. You got your hand up back there, right?
Yes.
Okay.
It's like an extension of the question.
Uh-huh.
Which was, whoever are aware of there being no only the requirement to respond to the law of the Spirit of Life, obedient, have permission or are at liberty to just disregard that which seems to have been good that was promoted by the law of sin and death. She was asking that.
Okay.
However, what has been puzzling to me, it seems to be a translational problem, because I have always thought that whatever is created is eventually destroyed. You know? And we were looking at, Dr. Frank Lewis was saying, you know, the reality is, what did he say now? The creator and the created. Mm-hmm. Well, I've always looked for a very long time, years ago, at the reality as I see it, as being the creator, the created, and the offspring. And I've always been saying, well, the offspring are the offspring of Yahweh Elohim Yahshua. He says, I'll never leave you nor forsake you, as always been with them. He has been rejoicing with the sons of men before the creation of the world. However, when we look at Ephesians chapter 2 verse 10 and 4 verse 24, it is clearly saying that whoever is glorified is created. So that is very puzzling to me. All right, so that's one question. And the other one, briefly, is how long did Adam remain undeceived? Was he always aware of himself being a sinner willingly throughout those 930 years? Or was it just initially he was not deceived? Thank you.
All right. Okay.
Let's see. Did you understand the question?
There was like three of them in there.
Yes, it's three. Yeah.
Okay, that, if I counted.
You want more proof on your stuff? So,
okay. Let me see if I could.
What?
If I could make this into one big bottle of wax. Okay. The first speaker said it quite well. He said, this is a subject that is really very expansive, and you can spend a day and a half on this, okay? In fact, I'll go as far as to say this. For a time, there was just a certain amount of charts, and then Dr. Kinley, he drew his last chart. Mm-hmm. I believe I have it in here. Yes, I do. He drew his last chart, which was this one. See? Yeah. The old folks used to call it the map. When Lee Warren got to it, he read something in the textbook and he kind of gave it another name. He called it a Daniel chart, and everybody kind of picked up on that. For those of you, this is what I'm talking about. Okay? Now, this is a lot more comprehensive exposition. In fact, you're tracking the mystery of iniquity. He asked me a question about the type and whether it was the spiritual reality to that. Because the high priest on the Day of Atonement, he had certain orders and procedures he had to do. Come in on the right side and sprinkle blood and turn this Ark of the Covenant around and then back out. All these kind of things. And the thing that it was shown to us in our conversation, that, well, what is the spiritual application for that? Because, see, the high priest here, he had to be on a specific course. You know, he couldn't deviate from that course. He had to do everything right. See? Yeah. And see, and if he, and look, he had bells and pomegranates on the edge, you know. Look, this is a scripture, I think, I don't know where it's at, but it says, Yahweh is in his holy temple, that all the earth keeps silent. Yeah. Why? Because on the Day of Atonement, see, all the tribes were around it, and they had to shut up, they had to muzzle their animals, because they had to hear this high priest doing his, they had to hear them bells, right. Him doing his duty. If they couldn't hear them bells anymore and he hadn't came out, then he'd have messed up.
Yeah.
See, he done did something wrong and Yahweh slew him up here. And look, them folks was not going to go beyond that curtain to go get him. Mm-hmm. They would find some brass meat hooks or something. They would go under the curtain, you know, they try to feel him out. You know, oh, here he is. Come on, lads. Come on, y'all. That's what would happen. Likewise, Yahshua is the high priest in our heart and mind. And he is the one see, on a course. And he can't deviate from that course. And if you follow that course, you won't deviate from it either.
Right.
This is scripture. If you know where it's at, you know, where Peter walks on the water, I want that scripture.
Matthew 14 chapter.
Where is it?
Matthew 14.
Matthew 14? Yeah, I like that scripture for a moment. Because I like to make a point with that. Yeah, 14:22. Yes.
Matthew 14:22.
Uh-huh.
And straightway Yahshua constrained his disciples to get into a ship,
mm-hmm,
and to go before him unto the other side, while he sent the multitudes away.
Read.
And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up unto the mount apart,
mm-hmm,
to pray. And when the evening was come, he was there alone. But the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with the waves, for the wind was contrary. And in the fourth watch of the night, Yahshua went in unto them, walking on the sea.
Mm-hmm.
And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, mm-hmm, saying, "It is a spirit." And they cried out for fear. But straightway Yahshua spake unto them, saying, "Be of good cheer,
mm-hmm,
it is I, be not afraid."
Mm-hmm.
And Peter answered him and said, "Master, if it be thou, bid me come unto thee on the water."
Okay, now hold it for a moment. Let me just get this in here and then we'll continue. Now, that's a fulfillment. Because see, when people read that, and even when I thought so too, because I grew up in church, that Yahshua physically walked on that water. Mm-hmm. But that's not what happened. See, he was up in a mountain.
That's a child project.
See, and he constrained his disciples to get into a boat and go out to the middle of the sea. Physically, he's still up in the mountain. But now he's astral projecting out onto the water. Why? Because it's the Spirit walking across the water, moving across the face of the deep. Why? It's a fulfillment back here. The earth inundated with water, and we have the Spirit of, you know, of Elohim moving across the face of the deep. We have it again in a type with Noah, because the ark is a type of the Spirit of Elohim, and it's moving across the face of the deep. Okay? Here's this cloud. And there's an angel in the cloud, and the dividing waters of the Red Sea, and they led them across. And a spirit of Elohim moving across the face of the deep. It's the same thing in principle. All right? But here's another point I want to draw out from that. And she's going to read it. Because see, Peter, he sees this, and he says, you know, "Master, let me come on out with you."
Yeah.
All right? Continue.
"Bid me to come unto thee on the water."
Read.
14:29 of Matthew. "And he said, Come. And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water,"
mm-hmm,
"to go to Yahshua."
Why? Because he got on the water, he was looking at Yahshua, and he started walking on the water. Read.
"But when he saw the wind boisterous,"
now let's look at this.
"Afraid."
Let's look at this plate right here. Alright? See, here's these folks here, carnal ordinances, but then here you are. You've been drawn out of that, and now you're on the pathway of the way, the truth, and the life, and you have your eyes on Yahshua. But now, like Peter did, long as he kept his eyes on Yahshua, he was fine. But then he started looking around.
Right.
And he started seeing the turbulence of the storms, you know. And he started, and what happened?
"When he saw the wind was boisterous, he was afraid and beginning to sink."
And he began to sink. That's what happened to many of us. That came to class, and they, you know, and at first they were like, "Yeah, this is good." And then something happened, and they lose interest or faith, or and they leave. What happened? Just like Peter out here. See, when they came out, they had their eyes on Yahshua. But then while they were walking, they got distracted by these things, by these false prophets, deceivers, and anti-messiahs, you know, concepts. You know, they took their eyes off Yahshua and started looking at this and started looking at that, and then they began to sink.
Yeah.
See what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Finish that, please.
"And when they saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid and began to sink."
Mm-hmm.
"He cried, saying, Master, save me."
Mm-hmm.
"And immediately Yahshua stretched forth his hand and caught him,"
mm-hmm,
"and said unto him, O thou of little faith,
mm-hmm,
wherefore dost thou doubt?"
Why did you doubt? I was here. I was in front of you. Why did you doubt?
Right.
See, you took your eyes off me. See, you know what they say about, the, you know, they say keep your eyes on the prize.
Yeah.
You know, when you take your eyes off it, then you try to come back like, oh, what happened?
Yeah.
Where am I? Whoa. I used to be a military man. I used to be in the United States Navy. All right, and I've sailed on the seas. And I'm going to tell you something. I've been in a couple of storms. One of the worst storms I was in was in one in New England. And it was in the winter. Whoa. And it was scary. Because I had to be on watch, you know, you have to have people outside. And I'm telling you, I almost got thrown overboard, you know, and I just caught myself on the railing just before I went over. And listen, if I had went overboard in the middle of this New England storm, that would have been it. You know, I'm not that great a swimmer. Plus, it was wintertime and it's cold,
yeah.
You know, and it's storming and it's noisy. And I mean, I could scream as loud as I want, nobody would hear me.
Yeah.
The winds and the waves, I mean, they're so high. I mean, it's a fearsome sight. I mean, there was at one time the waves were so high, it looked like the ship I was on. Look, I was on a 63-ton destroyer, and it just pushed it around like it was like a leaf. You know, it looked like I was trying to sail uphill. It's just that, you know, I mean, the ocean, I mean, look, sailing on the ocean is not like sailing on a lake or a river. It's a totally different thing.
Yeah.
All right? And you can easily die out there. See, and that's what Joshua's trying to show in this analogy here. Right. See, there's a vast ocean of false doctrines and mm-hmm. philosophies and stuff, and you can easily fall overboard mm-hmm. if you don't keep your eyes on the prize.
Yeah.
True. See, and that's the thing. And see, and that's the thing me and Mr. Gordon was talking. We came to the conclusion. I said, well, look, it's Joshua who's the high priest in your heart and mind. And he's the one that, you know, is going to guide you.
Right.
Dr. Kinley would say this. He would say, look, just because the law is out doesn't mean that you have the right to run a red light.
That's right.
You know? Yeah. Really.
Common sense.
All right? Yeah. Now, and we will obey the laws of man for man's sake. But hey, as our founder says, hey, we will stand up for our divine rights.
Oh, yeah.
Okay? We'll stand up for that. See? Now, I think I answered that one part of the question, I hope. The creation. The first speaker brought it up about these attributes. Let's get the scripture. Ezekiel 28:11. Because see, Satan said, I will be like the Most High. And I'll tell you, he's relentless. You know? And he has all the attributes, but one thing he does not have that the founder says he doesn't have is remorse. And see, and that just gives him the ability to just go out, you know, I mean, just, you know, with just full force, and you know, and he's gonna do what he can. Can we have that?
Ezekiel 28:11, you want?
Yeah.
Moreover, the word of Yahweh came unto me, saying, Son of man, take up a lamentation of the king of Tyre, and say unto him, Thus saith Yahweh Elohim, Thou sealest up the sum, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty.
Mm-hmm.
Thou hast been in Eden, the garden of Elohim. Every precious stone was thy covering.
Okay, now this is what the first speaker brought up. I'm just going to try to elaborate and just nail it down a little bit more. See, because see, here, this is Elohim. We know him to be an organized set of attributes. Lucifer, and the whole creation is made of these attributes.
Right.
Bar none. I mean, it's like the first speaker said, you got to have a source and substance for something. And spirit is the source and substance for everything. Now, the question is, and he brought it up that some people, and it was brought to me, and I had to do a special workshop about it, where they were trying to say that the devil was equal to Elohim. I said, well, how can that be? If he's called the mystery of iniquity,
yeah,
you know, and I looked the etymology of the word iniquity up, and it means unequal.
Unequal, yeah.
So how is he? Yeah. So how are you going to have a creation equal to a creator when he's unequal to that? But that's the lie. Satan, his job, he's going to try to portend himself to be the equal. That's why the scripture says that he's transformed into an angel of light. Because if you don't know any better, and he appears to you, you would think that he was the or is the equal of Elohim mm-hmm. when he's not. But continue. Right.
Thou hast been in Eden, the garden of Elohim.
You've been there. Talking about Lucifer. He was there. Go ahead.
Every precious stone was thy covering.
Uh-huh.
the sardis.
And see, now see, that's these attributes. See, you count them off. See, one, go ahead.
Sardis. Topaz.
Two.
The diamond.
Three.
The beryl.
Four.
The onyx.
Five.
The jasper.
Six.
The sapphire.
Seven.
The emerald.
Eight.
The carbuncle.
Nine.
And the gold.
And gold, which would be kingdom, or ten. See, nine within ten. He has a kingdom too. If he says he's going to be like the Most High, then he's going to have a kingdom. That's what I was showing you about the other chart, about the human governments, about these kingdoms. See, they're his attempt to imitate these physical kingdoms, is his attempt to imitate the spiritual kingdom. The laws of the earth that governments make, they're there to imitate the law of the Spirit. Because that's what he does. See, Yahweh Elohim creates, whereas Lucifer imitates.
Yeah. Yep.
See, one creates, the other imitates. But if you don't know any better, it's like this. You know, there were people, you know, in the United States back in the 19th century, they had what was called the California Gold Rush.
Yep.
You know, the 49ers, you know, they came out, and, you know. But there were people, there were hucksters out there, you know, and there were people who were not so savvy. They couldn't tell the difference between gold and fool's gold, which is also called iron pyrite. And so, you know, there were people, you know, and they thought, oh, I got gold. And they go into their sales offices and they look at it and say, no, nothing here. It's just fool's gold. And it's iron pyrite, you know, it's worth nothing. But yeah. you thought you struck it rich.
Yeah.
See? And that's what the world has. Mm-hmm. Fool's gold.
That's right.
And see, and they don't know any better.
Right.
See, and until somebody come along and educate you and say, no, look, this is the difference between real gold and fool's gold. See?
Yeah.
And that's what we do as class. See, we educate you on the difference between the true doctrine and the false doctrine. Mm-hmm. The real gold and the fool's gold.
Right.
Okay, continue, please.
The workmanship of thy tabards and the pipes were prepared in thee in the day that thou was created.
Mm-hmm. Boy could sing. Pipes, this is that. Whatever you could do with the voice, he could do it. He could sing, he could talk, he could rap, he could hum, he could whistle. He was mellifluous, smooth. See, and he was a musician, because a tabret is like a tambourine, it's an instrument.
Yeah.
So he could play and sing, he can entertain you, he can woo you.
Mm-hmm.
See, continue.
Was prepared in thee in the day that thou was created.
Mm-hmm.
Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth.
Now he's the
have set thee so.
Now he's the anointed cherub that covered. What do you mean? He's on the veil. And Yahweh set him like that.
That's right.
Set him like that. See, mm-hmm. To cover. He separates you. He covers you from knowing who you are. That's why over here, look here. See this veil? See how it's torn?
Because
it has to be rent. See? So it can be revealed.
Right.
Who's really sitting on this throne.
That's right.
Because he'll fool you. He's an angel of light. He's the, on the fourth day of creation, you have the stars, you have the planet Saturn on the veil.
Yep.
It's a bright planet. You know, if you see it in the sky, I'm an amateur astronomer. I can find it when it's out there. I can mm-hmm. say, oh, that's Saturn right there.
Mm-hmm.
And it has it's the planet of the rings.
Yeah.
And see, in the rings, see, it's a spiritual principle. If you are encompassed in its orbit, then you are circumscribed to that ideology. You're hedged in, you know, in that ideology, see?
Yeah.
And that is what has happened in the world. It doesn't matter. You could say, well, I believe in Buddhism. Well, you got the Buddhist ring around you. You're circumscribed in Buddhism. All right, well, I'm a Muslim. Well, now you got the ring. You're circumscribed in Islam. Well, I'm an atheist. I don't believe in that. Well, we got rings for you too. Circumscribed. See, hedged in. And you can't, and you think you're in the right place. You think, oh, okay, this is pretty nice. Not knowing, like the previous speaker said, when you get out and look back on where you are, you be saying, damn, I was really doing that? I know I do.
Yeah.
But I was into a lot of stuff from the time from between 10, from age 10 to age 20. I explored a lot of things before I came into this. And I look back and I always say, damn, you know, I did this. Some cases was really, you know, kind of heinous when I look back on it. Because I used to be an amateur hypnotist. Yeah, 10 years old. And I used to hypnotize people, and I used to get into the occult. And I used to believe in reincarnation. You know, past life, what they call the transmigration of souls. I used to believe that, and I used to hypnotize people. And I would have them regress into their memories, and they would go back into their memories. They would remember when they was a kid, and they go back and remember when they were in the womb. And then they would remember a time before the womb, and I'm like, okay. Now I look back on it, I say, okay, now who am I talking to now? Okay, that kind of thing. See, you know, I didn't realize, you know, that I was opening a conduit, you know, to demonic spirits, you know, because that's what I was doing, hypnotize somebody and then have them experience all that. I was literally handing souls over to these spirits, opening up their minds to do that. Mm-hmm. When you stop and think about it, that's quite a heinous thing to do, really. And I really regret that. That's why when I came into class, I put all that aside and I never hypnotized no one again. Because I just felt no one should have that. I mean, we're already subject to all these advertisers. I mean, the power of suggestion through advertising, you know, our loved ones, our friends. You don't need somebody like me coming along putting something else on you, you know. See, and that's what it was, you know, and I regret that, you know, and I thank Yahweh for pulling me out of that, you know, so that I can at least look back on it and I can tell people about it, yeah. You know. I mean, you know, that kind of thing. But finish reading that, please. Mean the deviate.
Thou art an anointed cherub to cover that
uh-huh.
I have set thee so.
Read.
Thou was in the holy mountain of Elohim and has walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire.
That's the angels. See, we went through this the other night. We talked about Jacob's ladder. See how he dreamed and seeing, and he was immersed in this dream and he was elevated in the spirit and he saw angels descending and ascending on this ladder. Okay, continue.
Thou was perfect in thy ways from the day that thou was created.
Uh-huh.
Till iniquity was found in him.
Now here's the thing. Some people think that Satan was a righteous angel who went bad. And that's not true. He was bad from the get-go.
Right.
See? He was just under a time bomb. Now, consider this. He deceived one-third of the angels. There's something here in our textbook Dr. Kinley had written. It's in the third volume. It's page 29. It's under the section called Reproduction versus Birth Control. Who wants to read? You want to read, Val?
Sure.
Read the second paragraph.
Okay, volume 3, page 29,
uh-huh.
Second paragraph. This abundant physical birthright has to be manifest in order to be perfectly reflected in a spiritual realm.
Now see, the birth rate, what he's talking about is the birth rate down here in Egypt. See, when those 70 souls came down and they began to multiply, okay? Read.
When Elohim created the angelic host, they were without number.
Mm-hmm.
The stars of heaven typify the angelic host, and no one has been able to count them. They were created to serve, honor, obey, and glorify Elohim. But Satan caused a third part of them to fall,
mm-hmm.
Revelation 12, 4 through 5. This shows that Satan was operating in the spiritual realm to curtail the number of angels that would serve Elohim. Since angels do not procreate as physical beings, there is nothing that Satan could do in limiting their number, but he could influence a great number of them to worship
mm-hmm.
him rather than Elohim.
Mm-hmm.
And the result would be the same as if they had been created.
Wait, try that again.
Could influence a great number of them to worship him rather than Elohim. And the result would be the same as if they had been created.
Had been created or been not created?
Had not been created. Big, important point.
I read that section too many times.
Yeah.
Okay. Had been not created.
Just
okay, in other words, what we're talking about, consider this. If he drew one-third of the angels, and the angels are innumerable, then one-third of innumerable is innumerable.
That's right.
And when he drew them, it was as if they had not existed. You know, had not existed. In other words, mass murder on a scale that is unprecedented. I mean, people talk about Hitler or Stalin or Pol Pot. You know, they mass murder. They ain't got nothing on this guy. To mass murder one third of an innumerable host of angels, which is innumerable. Again, that is mass murder. That's inconceivable.
That's right.
Yeah.
Jeez. And that was just up in heaven. Now he's down here.
Yeah.
Doing the same thing. See? Exact same thing. Continue.
Okay, the result would be the same as if they had not been created.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there can be nothing but the same thing happening in the physical plane as happened in the spiritual realm.
Uh-huh.
For the visible things portray the invisible things.
See, we can look at the visible things, and Dr. Kinley uses the time that the Israelites were in Egypt to show how what's happening with Satan in heaven. See, because just as Pharaoh, see, if you remember the story, Joseph was down here. And there was a Pharaoh that was very favorable to Joseph.
Right.
He put the government on his shoulders. Mm-hmm. Okay? And then when you read in Exodus, you read about, then there arose a Pharaoh that knew not Joseph. Now, it wasn't that he didn't know about Joseph. He just didn't have any respect for him. Joseph was a type of El Shaddai. Mm-hmm. So when it says that he knew not Joseph, what it's saying was he knew not Elohim, or he had no respect for Elohim. See, he appeared there, yeah, just like Lucifer appeared. He just appeared in heaven. And he appeared and said, oh, hello, here I am. I'm here. I'm your salvation. And one third gravitated to him. See,
yeah.
Now, is there anything else there?
Yeah, therefore, the Apostle John sees in his vision on the Isle of Patmos,
mm-hmm,
this great red dragon,
mm-hmm,
Satan, standing before the woman, Virgin Mother Earth,
mm-hmm,
or the Virgin Mary, ready to devour her son as soon as he was born.
See, that's this illustration here. Here it is. This is plate 14. See here. It was brought out how Satan was cast out, and that one third followed him, and here he is. That's the dragon. Here's the earth, the unformed earth. He's there. He's waiting. He's there. He's out there waiting. And seeing the creation is going on, and even sees the man being created, but Satan ain't did nothing. Because he saw the man created standing there in the garden. He didn't do nothing. Why? Because he looked just like the same one that kicked him out. But then when the woman was taken out of him, he recognized that because, oh, a bride. Why? Because he went after the bride up here. Same MO.
Yeah.
Same modus operandi.
Yep.
See? Going after the bride.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Continue.
This is an act of birth control on the part of Satan.
This is an act of birth control. Now, that should tell you something. If Satan is into birth control, then what is the purpose of Yahweh? Offspring.
Procreation.
Propagation.
Right.
If his purpose, talking about Satan, is birth control, then the purpose of Yahweh is offspring. See what I'm saying? Continue.
He is trying to keep the offspring from being born,
mm-hmm,
and trying to kill it after it is born.
Mm-hmm.
He is thus Yahweh's opponent and tries to impede the purpose of Yahweh.
Mm-hmm.
There is another instance of this effort on the part of Satan to kill off those that Yahweh has caused to be born and for Herod. For Herod had commanded at that time of the birth of Yahshua the Messiah that all the Hebrew children 2 years and under be slain.
And 2 years and under be slain. Why? Because it's a fulfillment back here with Moses.
Yeah.
Because he killed the boy babies 2 years and under back here looking for Yahshua.
Here again is Herod is the satanic type, and he is attempting to control the birthing of the righteous Yahshua from the womb.
The birthing of the that's when people get their birth son got doctrine from. They read that in the oh, see, it's right here in the textbook. See, the birthing. I've had a couple folks tell me that. I thought, oh, y'all trying to justify this now. No, hey, you know that ain't what it's saying. Okay, that's good enough from the textbook.
Right.
Thank you. If you can go back to Ezekiel. Because, see, she just read about Herod fulfilling what happened back here. They killed the boy babies two and under here. They killed the boy babies two and under here. And listen, there's a witness in the 20th century for that. Dr. Kinley received his vision in 1931. In 1933, you had the rise of Adolf Hitler, who became Chancellor of Germany. And from 1933 to 1945, which is 12 years, he persecuted the Jews. Why? Because just like back here, he's looking for that one. But see, the age has changed.
and the dispensation has changed. See, we're in a spiritual age, a spiritual dispensation. Before, the Hebrews were physical. The Jews were physical. In this age, they're spiritual. But Satan don't know that. Because he has no spiritual knowledge. And so he and Hitler went out, he rounded up all the Jews, 6 million of them, and killed them, trying to look for that one. But the Jew is spiritual. But when did he do it? In 1933. Why? 2 years after 1931. Can you see he's looking for that one? Two and under? Same thing, just a repeat. See, but Yahweh threw a curve. See, the Hebrew now is spiritual.
Yeah,
he
right.
put it in a black man. See? Mm-hmm. See that?
Yeah.
See, that's how Yahweh, I'm telling you, man. Yahweh, you get into this. Yahweh knows what he's doing. You know, and like me and Mr. Gordon, we agreed on this. I said, man, the course that he lays out is perfect. And when he lays his course out, he follows it. And he doesn't deviate, left to the right. Stays on that course. It's the same way with you. Because Yahshua is the high priest in your heart and mind. See, if you, like Peter, if you keep your eyes on him, you'll be fine. But if, like Peter, you take your eyes off, get looking this way and that way, looking at all the, see, you will sink. It's really that simple. Okay?
Yeah.
There was a third question here. How am I doing,
Radcliffe?
Yes. No, we answered the created. The reading says that all the angels were created.
Yes.
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 And that one third was deceived.
Yeah, they were deceived.
All right. So that means, though, I was saying offspring. So the scriptures, original scriptures, are obviously the Bible. They are using the word created and offspring elsewhere,
Yes.
Acts 17, 21, mm-hmm. whatever. Interchangeably, synonymously.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas I thought that, and I have created these so, that's Lucifer, he will have been destroyed because he was created, whereas the offspring is destined.
The whole creation is the offspring of Elohim.
No, I mean the word.
Listen to what I'm saying here. Mm-hmm. Here's Yahweh. He's pure spirit. Mm-hmm. All right? Pure spirit. Indescribable, inscrutable, abstract, etc. It didn't take all of Yahweh. You've heard this before, I know. To take on shape and form. Yahweh, pure spirit, went out of business. Yahweh Elohim is the Son. You can say he's the first cause of all creation. You can even say he's the firstborn of all creation. See? And the creation is derived from him. See, and that includes everything, see. And when he was created everything, he said it was good and very good. And we just read that the devil was right down here, waiting for the woman to be born. When he said it was good and very good, hey, that included him too. Not as him being a good person, so to speak, but he's good in his job. He's
yeah.
good in the purpose that he was created for.
He's a good delegation, yeah.
I'll throw you a loop right quick. And this is something Dr. Kinley said, and I'll tell you the transcript where he said it at. He said the devil will be back next week. Not next age, because he'll be destroyed. He'll be destroyed in this set of ages, but in the next set of ages, he'll be back. Because that's his reward for doing such a damn good job in this age. It's like, you got somebody cut the grass and stuff. He said, boy, you did a good job. I said, man, why don't you come back next week? I got some more work for you. Yes, ma'am.
So that means there will be creation.
There will be creation. There's a set of ages before this one. There are a set of ages afterwards. See? Yes, ma'am.
Will there be another physical creation?
That's a good question. I can't answer that, but I can't. What I can say is this. That at the end of the ages, and I'll put it here.
Remember what transcript that was in?
Discussion at San Luis Obispo.
Okay.
Yes, discussion at San Luis Obispo. Because they were talking around and the way he explained it,
that he'll be back in another manifestation. Now, as far as another physical creation, I would say this, and best I could say is this. At the end of the ages, we will be in Yahshua. And we in Yahshua will determine what the next set of ages will be. That's the only thing I could say on that. Now, however, whoever was in Yahshua in the last set of ages determined what was going to be in this set of ages. The way I understand it. And so now, it would be the same way. Now, whether it be a physical creation or not, I honestly cannot say. Only thing I can say is that we in Yahshua will determine the events of what will happen in the next set of ages. And it's something, and I don't know if this, you know, if it's relevant or not, but I know I think about this. Something. It was something Lee Warren told me years ago. He said, you know, it could be a situation where we could be going into, because everything is based on seven. And I remember, and it's beautiful the way he brought it up, because he talked about Dr. Kinley's lecture, December 3rd, 1975, which was really the first audio lecture I ever heard by Dr. Kinley.
Yeah.
And it's a very special lecture to me. It means a lot to me.
Yeah.
And I remember, and he said a lot of things on there. I mean, it's called Erroneous Doctrine, but he said a lot of stuff in there. It's really chock full of good information if you sit down and listen to it.
Yeah.
One of the things that I latched onto when I first heard it, and he said this, and it's in the textbook. Mm-hmm. He said this. He said, look. He said, you got to, and he was, man, good gosh, the man got off his deathbed. Right. To try to straighten these people out, man. I mean, the man was on his deathbed.
That's right.
You know, and he was hearing stuff, you know, what people saying. He was like, wait a minute, let me get up and go deal with this. Man, to get up, man. You know, I mean, I'm like, I
1975 or 76?
75. December 3rd, 1970. He died February 9th, 1976. I remember the day it happened.
Right.
Because, you know, we didn't have, you know, cell phones and stuff. It was the old days, you know, like telegraph, telephone, tele-negro, you know, that kind of thing, you know. You know, I heard about it. See, I think he died early in the morning. I heard about it. I was living in Illinois, and somebody called me up about 6:30. The chick, well, I was talking to you this morning, the chick I was there, the same chick, she was the one that called me up and told me that Dr. Kennedy had died. And the thing I asked was, wow, are they still going to have a peace mission? And she was like, there might not even be a world left after the day, you know?
Right.
Oh, those are days. Where we at?
We were talking about December 3rd, 1975, and there was something important.
Oh, yeah. He said this. He said there are 7 days in a week that ends with a Sabbath day. He says there are 7 months in a cycle of months that ends with the Feast of Pentecost. There are 7 years in a cycle of years that ends with a Sabbath. Mm-hmm. See, there are 7 times 7 Sabbaths in a cycle of Sabbaths that ends with a year of Jubilee. Mm-hmm. All right? And there are 7 millenniums that ends with a sabbatical millennium. Mm-hmm. And then there are 7 ages in a cycle of ages that ends with the day of eternity. And see, and here's what, and that's the part I want, I think. Let's see. I thought I had it.
The transcript.
You have the transcript?
Yeah.
San Luis Obispo?
Oh no.
Oh, you got that one. Oh, you have. Yeah, where he's talking about 7. You have that part?
No.
Okay, it's in there where he talks about the 7. Yeah, where he talks about that. And see, and look, it's a wheel in the midst of a wheel.
Right.
If I could put it like that. Ezekiel talks about it, and the way Dr. Kinley explains it, see, just from a physical standpoint. See, what's that? First volume page, I think it's 81, where you have the tabernacle. Yeah, here. See, you have the tabernacle here. See, here, the Israelites surrounding the tabernacle would be like one wheel. And then here you have the tabernacle here with this court roundabout that would be like another wheel. So you got a wheel in the midst of a wheel. Mm-hmm. See, and that's how, when we talk about the sevens, you know, what I just showed you, the 7 days in a week ending with a Sabbath day, that's one wheel, another one, that's another wheel. It's just multiplication, just repetition. You know, it's just like we'll beat you to death. Well, if you don't see it here, hopefully you'll see it over here. Yeah. Maybe you might see it over here, maybe over this way. So something, there's something on here you can see.
See? Mm-hmm. But most of all, you want to see it within you. Okay?
Yeah.
Mr. Radcliffe. Okay? Anything else? Do I need to elaborate on anything?
The only one, briefly. Adam's not being deceived.
He was not deceived, but he was a transgressor.
Yes, but he's not being deceived.
Well, see,
continuously, did he go for 930 years? Everything he did wrong. Was he aware that it was wrong, or was he, after a while, being deceived?
Here's what Dr. Kinley was saying. In fact, Rip Macklin, a guy I know, he had wrote a paper once, and he made some comments, and he sent it to the board, and it got rejected. Just to make a long story short, so he got kind of hot about it, and so he decided to come out to LA and have a special meeting with Dr. Kinley, you know, to try to, you know, find out, well, what's the deal with this, okay? And he brought a recorder with him. And what was recorded on there is what is called the Adamic Transgression transcript. And it's not a class, it's really like a board with Dr. Kinley and Dr. Harris, who else? Mathis, Dennis Jullard, Dr. Gross was there, you know, and maybe a few other folks in the audience. I mean, and Rip is presenting his case, you know. And see, and Dr. Kinley was trying to show him, you know, something. And Rip was saying, well, look, what I said this, I got it from this textbook. Because, see, he used the term Adamic transgression, mm-hmm. See? And Dr. Kinley had to admit, they said, well, you know, actually, it's not correct, but I do it that way because I got to deal with the world and keep the other fellow off me. But when you really stop and think about it, mm-hmm. See, Adam wasn't deceived, but he did transgress. But Yahweh meant for that to happen.
Oh, so that's why he changed to the use of the word Edenic.
Edenic, yeah.
Because look.
Because when you say Adamic, yeah. it, from a Christian point of view, it makes it seem like, you know, Adam, you know,
right.
In the words of what you just said.
Yeah.
See, that's how the Christians look at it. But what Dr. Kinley's trying to show is that, see, Adam within him, who was Elohim, see, Elohim in Adam knew what he was doing.
All the time.
Elohim in
Adam. 30 years.
Elohim in Adam knew what was happening.
Yes.
See, he knew what was happening.
Well, in that case, because of that, not if, but because, the appropriate adjective for the transgression would have to be inflexibly Edenic.
Yeah, Edenic. That's what happened. Matter of fact, I think it should be on here.
Since he was fully aware.
Yeah,
right to the.
Because it used to be Adamic transgression. Some of the older places, yeah, he did. He changed it to Edenic.
The Bible says Adamic.
See, well, Christians, because yes. Christians say that.
Yes.
That's what the Christians say. Well, Adam messed up and he sinned. Paradise lost and all that kind of thing.
We know he sinned.
See, the thing is, the Christians think that Adam wasn't supposed to sin. That's what they think, and that we should be living in this great paradise, you know, all like that. But see. What they're not understanding is that Yahweh purposed the man to fall. He purposed it that way. See, according to a plan.
I just changed.
Huh?
I have always been saying it's the Adamic transgression, in spite of what everything I heard. But since, I'm not saying it, since he is not being deceived was not just at the inception, but perpetually, never ever being deceived.
He wasn't deceived. He willingly died for his body. Look, yeah. Let's read the story.
That means it's
read the story says, you know, the man said, I mean, here's the woman, all right. Where was that? Here, all right. Here she is entertaining this bright, beautiful angel, okay? Mm-hmm. And then the man is looking, he don't see the angel, but he sees her looking at the tree. And so she plucks the fruit. Okay? And then she calls and says, here, honey. Now, he could have just said, nah, I'm good. he could have just as easily did that. But he didn't. He knew. He saw her. He told her.
Right.
But he willingly died for her. In fact, if you read the scripture, nothing happens until they both touch the fruit. It didn't say when she touched the fruit, bam, she instantly died. No, she touched the fruit and it's offered to her husband. And then when they took it, and then they died. Yeah.
Can I say something?
Sure.
The word transgression is used synonymously or interchangeably with the word sin. I never ever was saying that Adam did not sin.
Mm-hmm.
Adam sinned.
Yes.
All right? But the word transgression, you know, I'm chatting with you, I'm talking with you, I'm discussing, look, those are synonymous words.
What is sin?
All right. I'm not saying he didn't sin.
No, but see, what I'm saying is, what is the definition of sin?
What is
sin?
The transgression.
It's the transgression of the law.
That's it. You know? Transgression of the law. First, one minute.
Mm-hmm.
First John chapter 4, verse 5, or 3, verse 5. All right. But what I'm now looking at is that since there never ever came a second portion of a minute within his 930 years of physical living existence, when he thought that, there is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. He has never reached that stage.
Well,
he always saw that what happens as far as sin is concerned, he knows it's sin. So I'm not saying he didn't sin. And I'm not saying he didn't break the law. No, what I'm saying is, which I'm now seeing, is that because he was never deceived, 1 Timothy 2:14, the woman was deceived.
She was deceived, but he wasn't. She was deceived in the transgression, but he wasn't. He willingly
did
that.
In other words, Yahshua was never deceived.
No, he willingly went to the cross.
But he willingly.
He willingly did it.
A.B. Traynor says, sin offering for us. And the
King James
Version says he became sin for us. No, he became sin willingly.
Mm-hmm.
He became sin offering willingly.
All of that. Because
and
he's
yet he never sinned.
He's fulfilling.
Yeah.
He never sinned. But look, he came in the likeness of sinful flesh.
I'm not preaching.
He came.
I'm qualified.
But Adam needed a savior.
Right.
May I say this?
Go ahead.
I was the one who asked the question. The focus of it is that Adam remains a sinner, but we have the peripheral concerns about the word transgression. That's a troublesome word.
No, it's not. Because Adam needs. Look, look.
No, but
when Yahshua
sin is the transgression.
When Yahshua resurrected, guess what?
Huh?
Adam was in that crowd too.
Yes.
And look, I'll put it to you like this. Adam, for 930 years, was a man of sorrows because he looked upon the human race, his offspring, and saw them degenerate, until, what was said, the scripture says, evil continually. He watched that, he saw all of that.
And the opposite of that is that Yahshua looked upon the human race, at least a portion of it, and saw of the travail of his soul, and he was satisfied.
Yahshua came in the likeness of sinful flesh to conclude sin. Now, you and I would have looked at him, he would look just like any other Joe Blow.
Mm.
You wouldn't think, and even the scripture says, there was nothing comely about him or nothing like that. But yet, he came in the likeness. In other words, he was numbered with the transgressors, mm-hmm. even though he himself was not a transgressor. But he was numbered with them.
That's it.
See, why? For us.
So the simple answer is that he was never deceived.
No, Adam.
That's it.
Adam was never deceived.
And Yahshua
he
was
will,
never
yes,
deceived.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir.
I'm
sorry, Leon.
That's the merging, because he said we must become one.
We're going in an age of, the next age is the age of immortality, right? The next age is the age of immortality.
And dispensation.
Next age after immortality?
No, that's the age we're going.
That's the age we're going into, the fifth age.
What is going to immortalize?
Okay.
Oh boy.
We was going through the seven. There are seven millenniums in a cycle of millenniums that ends with a Sabbath of immortality. That's here. See, it says Sabbath here, and even though it says fifth age, but it's at the end of the seventh. Okay. Give me Acts. I think it's Acts 1 and... Is it 1 and 12? Somewhere around there.
It's Acts 1 and 12 is, then returned they unto Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is from Jerusalem a Sabbath day journey.
Oh, boy, I'm surprised I hit that. Yeah, a Sabbath day's journey. In other words, they could only walk so far on a Sabbath day. Okay, now, if this is a Sabbath here, I mean, okay, here we have here the revelation of Yahshua Messiah. This is the universal revelation of Yahshua Messiah, all right, where we go into the fifth age, you know, which dispensationally is a Sabbath of immortality, all right, and that's declared here in this fifth age. Now, from the fifth age to the seventh age is a Sabbath day's journey, because the seventh age is a Sabbath, it's a sabbatical age. Right now, we just read there that from the mount, read that again, Val.
They returned unto Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet.
Now, from Mount Olivet to Jerusalem,
which is from Jerusalem a Sabbath day's journey,
is a Sabbath day's journey. See, from Mount Olivet to Jerusalem is a Sabbath day's journey. Now, on the chart, Dr. Kinley outlines it here. Okay, here we are. This is eschatology. This is a descending plate. All right, the veils is the human race. These are veiled. See, and he's going to transcend the veil. And look, when he appears, it's going to be in a state of incorporeal visibility. That's to say this, everybody will see him, because this will be in a vision. All right, and then those who are not in Yahshua will see the glory that is Yahshua and us in Yahshua, and see that their clothes are as filthy rags, their concepts and such. They will be cast, we will cast them into the lake of fire. All right? Coming over here. Here we have the renovation of the earth. All right? Because Yahweh said that you can't put new wine in old skins. Right? And that's the principle here. So here we got the renovation of the earth. And here we have the new earth state, which would be the fifth age. Now the sixth age, that's called the age of perfect, according to the textbook. Now, mind you, it didn't say perfection. It said perfect. And see, when you look up the word perfect, see, the word perfect means intact. See, because all things must be subdued and put under his feet. And when all things are subdued and put under Elohim, then Elohim himself must be made subject to the Father. See, the sixth age is where everything is all subject, made subject to him. And see, and like the high priest, see, he's going to have to go beyond the veil, so to speak. And see, we have here the sabbatical, see, all in all. That's the seventh age. Because it's likened to the high priest going up on the Day of Atonement. And he's putting on the garments. See, look, where did he put on the garments of beauty and glory at? In the holy place. Well, he's putting us on, because we are glorified. So we in him, see, make up his garments, and he's going to present us before the Father. And then afterwards, just like the high priest, he's got to go up here, and the high priest, look, let me go here. The high priest goes up, he starts here at the altar of incense. He comes up, he changes his clothes into the garments of beauty and glory. Then he has to go on this side of the veil, go up this way with the censers, coals from the censers. And he gets between the Ark of the Covenant, and he sprinkles the blood, and while he's doing that, he's turning the Ark of the Covenant around to a circle, and by the time he finishes the seventh flick, his back right, and then he has to back out on this side and come down like this. Now, when you look at it from here, going like this, turning around like that, coming back like this, that's a figure eight. See, eight typifies a new beginning. So when he comes out from the seventh age, this is what he looks like. And this is the first age and the eighth age. The first age of a new, you know, or I put it like this, at the beginning of a new set of ages. He's got seven stars in his hand. He's the seven-branch lampstand, all right? That just shows you he's gone through seven ages. He's had seven stars in his hand. That signifies seven new ages. Really, it's just him, because the seven stars, if there's only one star, and that's him being manifested seven times. See, it would be like this. If I took a picture of Frank, you know, I've been to his house,
You know, I could take a picture of Frank in his living room. I could take a picture of him in his dining room and the den and in the kitchen, you know, and, you know, bedroom, you know, I could have like 6 or 7 portraits of him. And I could just lay it out. But is that 7 people? No, it's just one individual in 7 different localities, 7 right. different rooms. And that's the same way. It's Elohim appearing in all the 7 ages. See? See, that's him. It's the true sanctum of sanctorum, see? And see here, because he's fully clothed, whereas unlike in the beginning, here we have him nude. See? Why? Because him being nude shows that it's hidden in a mystery. Whereas him showing fully clothed, now it is revealed. Yes, ma'am.
Is it the when he says this mortal shall put on immortality?
That's right.
Is it the flesh?
No, no, it's not the flesh.
Oh,
flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of
okay,
Yahweh. See, all we can say is that the best we can say is that it's a glorified body likened unto Yahshua.
That's right.
That's the best we can say at this point. But we can say that it's not flesh. It's not physical. There's no flesh and blood involved.
Right.
And I know some people believe that. I know a few people that they think, oh no, we're going to be in these super flesh bodies where we won't get sick and we won't die and you know all this kind of
it's
no,
not flesh.
No.
Flesh.
Yahweh could have did that from the jump, okay?
Right.
If he wanted to do something like that,
not this body.
No, not this. This ain't going nowhere.
Yeah, it's true.
See.
You see?
Yes. Okay.
Yeah. You know, man.
I don't know. Any other questions? But my thing is, Dr. Kinley lays it out. I can't, only thing I can do is encourage people to take the time and review his work. And I'll tell you, the work, the vision will speak. It will speak and it won't lie.
Right.
You know, it won't lie. It will engage you. And you know, and I'll tell you something, if you happen to make an error on it, you know, the vision will straighten you out.
That's right.
It'll set you back. It'll set you straight.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, I know. I've had it happen.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, so the thing about, you know, well, we could do whatever we want, that's just not so. You know, you can't go out here and steal or take somebody's spouse or, you know, go murder somebody. You know, you can't do that.
No.
You know? See, Yahshua said this. It says, he said, be ye wise as serpents and harmless as doves. See? And I was having a conversation with Marcia, and it was a really good one because she was saying, you know, if you truly, you know, listen to what Yahshua is saying, man, Yahshua, well, he'll show you the pitfalls, you know, and how to avoid them, you know, and even if you just happen to be in one, Yahweh, you know, if Yahweh will show you the way out of it.
True.
You may not, ordinarily may not see an escape, but Yahweh has an escape
for
everybody.
Oh, yeah.
That's true.
You know, and he'll show it to you, you know, if you take the time to be patient and allow him to work his work.
Right.
His strange work, as the scripture says.
And
but it ain't strange. But it ain't strange to those, no, because hey, he operates by a universal pattern, but a universal spirit of law embedded therein. See? And that's the thing. We want to be, how can I put it? You know, we want to be cognizant of that law of the spirit that is within us.
Yeah.
We want to be that. So
yeah.
that So that like the high priest, we will perform our duties in our course without error.
Right.
Because it's Yahshua that's doing it. We don't want to be like what Peter did, man. Because we're coming out here, we're on this path, you know. Keep your eyes on Yahshua.
That's right.
See, and don't let the storms of, you know, of erroneous doctrine or the storms of concepts and opinions and hypotheses, don't let them distract you.
Imagination.
You know,
yeah.
All of that, you know, you just keep your eyes on Yahshua, see, because he said it himself. He said, why did you doubt? I'm right here in front of you.
Yeah.
Why did you doubt?
That's right.
All right.
Mm-hmm.
Any other questions?
One last simple one.
All right.
Tabernacle pattern, and then you have gates. So gate would be the east. where you have tabernacle pattern, that's the west.
Mm-hmm.
I'm looking at the big rendering of it.
East, west,
and
north,
the north,
south.
Okay.
I could throw something else in here right quick. Because it was mentioned, because he said that about the time that the first speaker talked about how the tribes, you know, he was talking about how
He said I would dwell in the sides of the north, okay, and that on the north side of the tabernacle was the tribe of Dan,
right,
which means judge. And so he said, I will stand in the judgment seat. See, now that's manifested because, see, back here when you had Saul, King Saul, he was the first king of Israel. At the time, Jerusalem was not, the Hebrews did not control Jerusalem. See, they weren't living in Jerusalem until David came and he conquered Jerusalem. All right, but before that, Saul never ruled in Jerusalem. In fact, he ruled in a city. It was called Mizpah. And if you look on a map, you see that the city of Mizpah is just a few miles north of Jerusalem. So, and from a physical standpoint, you got King Saul, who's a physical type. And then even in the textbook, Dr. Kinley says that Saul's 40-year rule over Israel was a satanic rule. And he ruled from a town called Mizpah, which was just a few miles north of Jerusalem. But Saul never ruled Jerusalem. Why? Because Satan will never rule the true Jerusalem, the spiritual Jerusalem. See, that's why. Okay, unless there's anything else, I'm about out of gas. Unless I could easily turn it over to someone else.
You're going
to
wrap up,
Calibre. We'll wrap. Okay, huh?
Yeah, we got another place to go.
Oh, okay. Then I will conclude. Thank you very much for your time and your patience, and praise Yahshua.
Beautiful. All right, now, so now we are at the end. Any announcement?
Just that we have class, I think, some before this.
Oh, so.
And this seminar.
There will be a seminar then on the next week. Saturday and Sunday.
23rd and 24th, yep.
Kingston. Chartlands. 10 a.m. until 6 p.m. All right. Okay, then. So now, class is also held at in Kingston at 94 B.O. Lower Road, Wednesdays and Fridays from 6 until 8, Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m., and over in Spanish Town at the St. Catherine High School, corner of Ellis and Young Street.
Spanish High School, that's where we have class.
This is St. Catherine.
We're in St. Catherine at the Spanish Town High School, corner of Ellis and Young Street, Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7 to 9. Sundays from 4 to 6. And also here at Mile Gully,
Sunday
from 4 to 6. Alright then. So please stand for a Dr. Sullivan. You know, unto him who is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before the presence of his glory, with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, Yahshua the Messiah, belong glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forever, we say.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Okay, who is Mr. and Mrs. Michelle? No, just a shout out from my Facebook, from Denise Campbell.
Okay, yes.
Praise
yes.
Yahshua. Praise Yahshua. Praise Yahshua.
Yeah, she made a shout out to y'all, so because she was watching.
Yeah, okay. Denise.
I guess she's still watching, I hope.
Yeah. Yeah. She's in London. She's
yeah.
He's in Yahshua.
Praise
Yahshua.
Praise Yahshua.
Well, Yahshua.
Good to see you.
You thank you.
Because it clogged up your system.
Grease. No, I'm fine.
Drink your cut garlic tea.
You're not even garlic.
You know, what is good for you?